by me, avita tattva, without knowing the actual fact, drusha, by experience, shabayam, in the assembly, kshiptaha, was abused, durukti, unkind words, vishikaihi, by the arrows of, viganaya, taking no notice of, tat, that, mam, me, arvak, downwards, patantam, gliding down to hell, arhattama, the most respectable, nindaya, by defamation, apat, saved, drishtya, seeing, ardraya, out of compassion, saha, that, Bhagavan, your lordship, swakritena, by your own mercy, tushyet, be satisfied. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki. Translation. I did not know your full glories. For this reason, I threw arrows of sharp words at you in the open assembly, although you did not take them into account. I was going down to hell because of my disobedience to you, who are the most respectable personality, but you took compassion upon me and saved me by awarding punishment. I request that you be pleased by your own mercy, since I cannot satisfy you by my words. Purport. As usual, a devotee in an adverse condition of life accepts such a condition to be the mercy of the Lord. Factually, the insulting words used by Daksha against Lord Shiva were enough to have him thrown perpetually into a hellish life. But Lord Shiva, being kind toward him, awarded him punishment to neutralize the offense. King Daksha realized this and, feeling obliged for Lord Shiva's magnanimous behavior, wanted to show his gratitude. Sometimes a father punishes his child, and when the child is grown up and comes to his senses, he understands that the father's punishment was not actually punishment but mercy. Similarly, Daksha appreciated that the punishment offered to him by Lord Shiva was a manifestation of Lord Shiva's mercy. That is the symptom of a person making progress on the path of Krishna consciousness. It is said that a devotee in Krishna consciousness never takes any miserable condition of life to be condemnation by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He accepts the miserable condition to be the grace of the Lord. He thinks, I would have been punished or put into a more dangerous condition of life due to my past misdeeds. But the Lord has protected me. Thus, I have received only a little punishment as token execution of the law of karma. Thinking of His grace in that way, a devotee always surrenders to the Supreme Personality of Godhead more and more seriously and is not disturbed by such so-called punishment. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manovishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahyam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Sri Guru Sri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Sri Vishakanvitamscha हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधो दीन बंधो जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांता राधा कांता नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरंगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये वांचा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामीनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे नमो ओम श्रीपदाक्षण पृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते जय पताक स्वामिनीति नामिनि नमः आचार्य पादायनि तत्कृपपदायनि गौरकतदामदायनि नगरग्रामदायनि मूकं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लङ्घयते गिरिमत्कृपातमहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुं दीनदारिणं हरे कृष्ण फर्स्ट आई लाइक टू थैंक सुबंधु प्रभु फॉर गिविंग मी सच एन अपॉर्चुनिटी टू ग्लोरीफाई Srimad Bhagavatam and the Vaishnavas, and I am seeking blessings from all the Vaishnavas so that my words be worthy of hearing. And so being in a fallen soul, so only by the mercy of the Vaishnavas where I can speak some words which will be worthy of hearing. Thank you. So as we are discussing on Lord Shiva's, so the previous chapter also, the sixth chapter, it is completely glorification of Shiva, where Brahma is coming and glorifying him. And it's pleasing him to come and give benediction to Daksha Prajapati. But this we are discussing from past 4 to 5 months. So I hope many of the speakers have already covered the part of Daksha, Shiva, Sati, these things. And today I take an opportunity to glorify Lord Shiva. So I'd like to speak on Shiva Tattva, so which is really very difficult to understand, and many devotees, even after coming to Krishna consciousness, feeling so many difficulties to understand who is Lord Shiva and what is the difference between Lord Shiva and Krishna. And there are many tattvas where it is very difficult to understand, and it is little bit of what I can say secret, like rahasya, where you couldn't understand so easily. So Krishna also says in Bhagavad Gita, तेषां सतयुक्तानां भजतां प्रीतिपूर्वकं ददामि बुद्धियोगं तं येन माम् उपयान्ति ते. So only by the mercy of Lord we can understand certain things in spiritual. So this happens when you surrender completely to the Lord. So sometimes you can see that speaker is saying something, we are hearing the same thing, but you can see a differences who are hearing, one will be having one own kind of understanding. That understanding is because depends on the surrender, how much you are surrendering to the Lord, so how much you are engaged in the Lord's service. So much it is revealed to you. Ye tamam prapadyanse tam statai bhajamyam. So in this way, there's, so I'd like to say about Shiva. Shiva have many names. We call many, devotees call in many names, like they say him as Devadidev, Mahadev, Maheshwara, Ashitosh. Then they call him as Vaishnavanam Yatashambho. So here creating many differences, like it is they called as Maheshwara, and it is called as Vaishnavanam Yatashambho. He is a devotee also. He is a Maheshwara also, Mahadev, Bholenath, so many names. And you can see in the previous also, where during the time of Ramanujacharya, where the king was a Shaivite king, and because of the king's lack of knowledge, I can say, was not knowing complete knowledge of what is Lord Shiva and what is Krishna, who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead like. So they had a rule that only everyone should be a Shaivite. So there was a situation where Ramanuja should leave the place and he came to Melkote. And there was a severe punishments for Vaishnavas. And Kulashekar Alvar also, you know that, his eyes were burnt because he was chanting the holy names of Lord Krishna. So they were against Vishnu. So Shaivites, they think Lord Shiva was the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They never considered Vishnu to be supreme. And even in Vaishnava community, we see that some devotees, they think, no, Vishnu is the supreme, not Shiva. Because this is all happening because of lack of knowledge. And we can see generally, there are four tattvas, which is very difficult to understand. The four tattvas are like Radha tattva, Dham tattva, Guru tattva, and finally it is Shiva tattva. And you can see, why I'm giving this background things means you could understand. So how difficult it is to understand Shiva. It's not so easy. So Radha tattva. First, Radha tattva, you can't understand who is Radha. Right? Radha, you can see the birth of Radha. Even it is a big mystery. And we say it's Rushabhanusute. We say that father of Srimati Radharani is Rushabhanu. But finally, when you go internal, you see that she is not daughter of Rushabhanu. She is coming from that Himalayan rivers, and he is taking care of Radha. And it's all complete mystery. And you can see you can see her as an ordinary lady who was a lover of Krishna, and always she serves Krishna. And once again, her marriage is a big mystery. We can say Radha's husband is, they say Abhimanyu is Radha's husband. And once again, they say, no, it's Krishna. And we have many, this thing, what is that? Proof also that she has got married to Krishna 3 times. Brahma had married her. And Abhimanyu also was, it was Krishna during the Brahma Vimochana Lila that time. So Abhimanyu form also was Krishna. This something like this. And so many things, so many doubts you have. And the ending of Srimati Radharani also, nobody knows what is the ending of Srimati Radharani. And finally we say she is the internal potency of Lord Krishna. So many confusions because we are not able to understand. We can read all the scriptures. We can hear all the Acharya's lecture. Still we are not able to understand. Why is this? Because we are not surrendered to Krishna. Krishna is not revealing to us these secrets. He reveals the secrets only to Acharyas who is completely surrendered to the Lord. And the second, Dham Tattva. Once again, Dham Tattva is once again a big mystery. Who have seen Vrindavan? Good. What have you seen in Vrindavan? I'll share my experience. The first time Vrindavan, when I went, I had a big imagination. Vrindavan is a spiritual world. So what is the meaning of Dham? Where the pastimes of Lord has happened, and it is a spiritual place. So it will be very transcendental. Something will be glowing in Vrindavan. We thought that as soon as step down of Vrindavan, everybody were giving obeisances. Even I gave obeisances. Then I see it was all open gutter and pigs are running here and there. So many, and it was smelling so badly. I thought, what is this? We say Vrindavan, it's a spiritual. But anyhow, we had before going to Vrindavan, they had guided us. So we shouldn't offend Dham. But internally, we have certain things. Internally, I was not, what is this? And there's a small story on this also. A person who was a foreigner, just by hearing the lectures of Srila Prabhupada, he was so inspired to see Vrindavan. And from there, he came to Vrindavan. He landed in Vrindavan. He took a taxi and came to Vrindavan. He entered Vrindavan and just saw the picture of Vrindavan, that it was so open savages with smelly things and this material things he saw. And finally, not even without entering Vrindavan, he took a return flight and went back. And it is not easy to enter a dham. Only this material things you can see. You can't see the spiritual. Actually, these things are not seen. It has been heard. We should hear, then only we get a vision to see that. So once again, dham. And what about Mathura? And so many dhams like Mathura. Mathura is the birthplace of Krishna. I am sharing my personal experience. I don't know what is your experience. When I went there, I saw a big masjid there. There's a mosque. And where I'm just searching there, we went in a queue and there's a small, cage like the child where Krishna took birth. And it is not total, I am not offending, like, but still, I do not feel it is a dham. Only because of the association of devotees, I felt, yes, it's a place of spiritual. But when there is no devotees, you don't feel that it's dham because you can't have a vision of it. And you can see what is Ayodhya. Even in Ayodhya, we had a very big queue and it was all guarded with military. And we went, and the deities were very small in a big place, very far it is. We had a darshan and came. And many devotees after coming, they were asking, where is the darshan? We asked, did you not have darshan? No, we were seeing that military person we were having, we were seeing that and we came out. And for a long queue we went, they did not have the darshan also. Just imagine, it is so... It is not that everybody go to dham also you can have darshan. We guided them so well, we guided completely, even then they were not able to have darshan. So it is not so. This is all called as secret, very rahasya tattvas, where you can't understand without surrendering to the Lord. And Krishna in Bhagavad Gita says, Bhaktya mama vijanati yavanyaschatmi tattvaha. Even Bhagavad Gita can be understood only by a devotee. Without being a devotee, it's like open secret. Secret is a thing where it is covered, but Lord's things all, it's very open. You can take it, but never you can understand that. So even in 9th chapter, some Rajavidya Rajaguhyam Pavitram Idamuttamam Pratyakshavagamam Dharma Susukam Karna. It says Rajavidya Rajaguhyam. It is secrets of king of all secrets. It's open, but even it's a secret. And finally it is Guru Tattva. Even Guru Tattva, it's very difficult to understand. We see Guru as an ordinary man, right? It's something a person like, an ordinary man like us. Even he eats, he sleeps, he drinks, he does everything. And finally, Shastra, what it says, it's Sakshad Haritvena. That means, is direct Hari. He's a representative of the Lord, they say, and he's direct Hari. You have to treat him as Supreme Personality of Godhead. Once again, we are not able to do that. Only by the words of senior Vaishnavas, by their mercy, we just serve Guru, but still we are not able to get that feeling that Guru is the Supreme Lord. Why? Because still we are not surrendered so much to the Guru and the Lord. And in this way, Shiva Tattva. It is one among these four. Shiva Tattva is very difficult to understand. Fine? So today we can know something about Shiva Tattva. So many know. Already I think many have heard about Shiva Tattva. They have explained many things. Actually, Brahma explains this in Brahma Samhita. So Brahma explains not only about Shiva, he explains about Ganesha, Durga. So what is the relationship, how, and himself also explained this. And it is, the shloka is, Shuram yata dadi vikara vishesha yogat sashayate nahi tata pritagasti heto ya shambhu tamapi tata samupaiti karyat govindamadipurusham tamaham bhajami. And the translation is like this. Just as milk is transformed into curd by the action of acids, but yet the effect curd is neither same as nor different from its cause, wise milk. So I adore the primeval Lord Govinda, of whom the state of Shambhu is a transformation for the performance of the work of destruction. So here Brahma is explaining what? He's comparing, is giving an analogy like milk is like Vishnu and yogurt is Shiva. So milk is transformed into yogurt. That is, your Vishnu is transformed to Shiva. But never yogurt can transform to milk. So we can't come back. You can say that Shiva is coming from Vishnu and Shiva and Vishnu are equal. You can say many things, but the qualities of milk is different, the qualities of yogurt is different. And you can see the qualities of yogurt also. Yogurt, by yogurt, what all you can do? You can just do only limited things, right? You can do buttermilk or something like this. But what about milk? It has so many forms. You can do kheer, rabdi, and so many other items, so many sweet items you can do. In the same way, Vishnu has many avatars or many incarnations, many leelas to be seen. But Shiva is limited. But still, without Shiva, we can't attain Vishnu. I'll come later part explaining these things. because I said it is already, this Shiva Tattva is difficult to understand. And it is something, and now, before it was difficult, but by the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, somewhere we are getting that secret, how to understand this. What is the Tattva which Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has given us? Achintya Veda Aveda Tattva. What it is mean by it? Achintya, Veda and Aveda. There is difference and there is no difference. Yes, there is no difference between Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu, and there is difference between Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu. So this is the understanding. When you go in this path, then you will be able to see the real picture of what is it. Then you will be able to understand what is Shiva. Who is Shiva? It's a long explanation, and here you can see in this Brahma Samhita also, in the last point where Brahma is saying, transformation for the performance of the work of destruction. So it is said the three gunas, three avatars, the Brahma, Vishnu and Maheshwara. We say one is creator, one is the maintainer and one is the annihilator. And here Brahma is also saying that, so where the form of Shiva is coming to annihilate. And now the question is the Vishnu only maintainer? He can only maintain, he can't do anything other than that? Right? Brahma is the creator, Vishnu is the maintainer, and Shiva is the annihilator, right? Okay, now Vishnu is the only maintainer, he can't create? Can he create or no? He's the first creator, okay. He can't annihilate? Okay, if this is right, then how is that Shiva can only destroy, only annihilate, he can't create or he can't maintain? Yes? So, to know more depth in it, we can go more little detailed about it. So, as I said, Shiva has many names. So, even in Krishna, he has many names. When you go through Bhagavad Gita, you can see Rishikesha, Govinda, Achyuta. So one more name contains its qualities. It's not like that some name they have and we are just calling them by that name. Even when we get initiated, Guru gives us a name. So there's a lot of meaning behind that name. When you go through that, you'll understand why my Guru has given me this name. For example, you have some false ego or something. So Guru gives a name, by just calling you by that name, the false ego goes within you. You have some lusty desires. By certain names, just calling you by that name, the lusty desires which you have will be losing. That's the mercy of Guru. It's not that simply Guru is giving some names and we are getting that name. No. It's transcendental, it is divine, where you're not able to understand by our limited senses. That's why Guru is called as Sakshat Aritvena. So the just an ordinary being, we get a name and that has a meaning behind it, then what to say about the Supreme Lord or Lord Shiva having a name and without a meaning or without a quality? So, your Shiva will be called in many names like Shambhu. So, who is Shambhu? You heard about Shiva as Shambhu also, no? So, who is Shambhu? Then, who is Shiva? Who is Rudra? Then, who is Sadashiv? So, these are the names. So, behind this, I had a big research seeing this, what is names, so I got many other things to know about it. So now we can go according to the creation, maintenance and annihilation. So when you start up to know about creation and what is the part of Shiva in this creation, how he gets involved in this creation. So we know that. So creation, how it happened. So first it is creation started by Krishna. So he expanded to Balaram, right? And from Balaram it is Chaturvyuh. And from Chaturvyuh it is Narayana. And from Narayana, another Chaturvyuh where Mahasankarshan comes. And from Mahasankarshan, Mahavishnu is made. And by Mahavishnu, this material that is called as Mahatattva is been created. So Lord Vishnu is transcendental. He has been untouched by the three modes of nature. So he is transcendental. There are two kinds of achintya, where I was referring that. Two kinds of achintya. One is touched by the three modes of nature, and one is untouched by the three modes of nature. Even Lord Shiva also is Achintya, and Supreme Lord Vishnu is also Achintya, but is untouched by the three modes of nature. So, and we know that how Lord Vishnu creates this material world. How he creates? Just by his vision. Just by his vision, he is creating this material world. And how that creation is happening? So, by his one vision, by his one eye, he is creating Jiva Shakti. From his one vision, one eye vision is coming Jiva Shakti, and other eye you are getting Kala Shakti. So Jiva Shakti and Kala Shakti, and with the mixture of three modes of nature, you get a form of Shambhu. That is Shambhu, who is the creator. But the creator is Mahavishnu, is creating through Shambhu. And who is Shambhu? Shambhu, who is the creator of all the universes, is the only person for all the universes. He is not Shiva, he is Shambhu. So he is the control of three modes of nature, where all the universes has been controlled, where it's working on these three modes of nature. And Mahavishnu, after the creation of all the universes, Mahavishnu enters each universe by expanding to Garbhodayak Shai Vishnu. In the same way, even Shambhu expands to Shiva. We always hear about Shiva, no? So that Shiva is within each universe. The Shambhu transforms to Shiva, not transforms, he expands to Shiva and enters to each and every universe. So that is a form of Shiva. And then what is Rudra? Rudra, it is Shiva who expands to 11 Rudras. That is during the annihilation, during the destruction, during the annihilation, Shiva expands to 11 Rudras. And there is one more form I was saying, that's Sadashiv. Sadashiv is non-different than Narayana himself. And I said it was not the form of Shiv. And for this, I have certain references in Srimad Bhagavatam only. Just I want to read this translation so where it will be very clear to you. So somewhere we have a confusion. Even I had gone through these chapters, that is previous chapter, sixth chapter, because I was not hearing the Bhagavatam class about the speakers. I don't know what kind of class, how they explained this. But certain translations where it was really very much confusing like. So to be very clear, I'll just read out the translation of Srila Prabhupada, where it becomes very clear for us. So here, the chapter name is Brahma Satisfies Lord Shiva. The sixth chapter, 42nd verse. Lord Brahma says, "My dear Lord Shiva, I know that you are the controller of the entire material manifestation, the combination father and mother of the cosmic manifestation, and the supreme Brahman beyond the cosmic manifestation as well. I know you in that way." What your Brahma is saying? You are the supreme. You are the creator of this material cosmos. You are manifesting it, right? We, as Vaishnavas, we always think it is Vishnu. But Shaivites always, they think it is Shiva. Here it is the controversy always. Shaivites say it is, no, it is Shiva is supreme, and Vaishnavas say it is Vishnu supreme. And even Bhagavatam is saying the same thing. So here we have that controversy. We are not able to understand certain things. And the next shloka, "My dear Lord, you create this cosmic manifestation, maintain it and annihilate it by expansion by your personality, exactly as a spider creates, maintains and winds up its web." And Srimad Bhagavatam saying is this. This has been said by Bhagavatam, and Brahma is saying this. So Brahma, we can't just think where even Prabhupada says, Ardha Kukuta Nyaya. You take a book of Bhagavad Gita, you should accept everything, no? Not that you accept one part and you don't accept another part. Even Bhagavatam, not that you accept some part and you don't accept that some other part. That means somewhere we feel that I am not able to understand this, so we'll leave out this part and we take out which we are able to understand. So every word of Srimad Bhagavatam is considered. You should understand always, I am not in a position to understand that. But whatever a word is said in Bhagavatam, it is truth. It is acceptable. I am in not that transcendental this thing where I am not able to understand that. Not that Bhagavatam is saying something contradictory, this one kind in one thing and other kind in other way. Both are same, but I am not able to understand that. Right? And the last one, it is more confusing. That's the 46th verse here is saying, My dear Lord, devotees who have fully dedicated their lives unto your lotus feet certainly absorb your presence as Paramatma in each and every being. It is more confusing. Always we say, Krishna is as Paramatma is in everyone's heart. Right? Right, no? Krishna also says in Bhagavad Gita, what he says? Sarvasya chaham ridhi sannivishto matta smritir jnanam aponamsha. I am recited in everyone's heart, and it is me who is giver of the knowledge, the intelligence, the forgetfulness and remembrance. Right? And what is this? Then you should know who is inside the heart. Is it Shiva or Krishna? And which form we have? Lord in which form inside? Which form? Narayana form. Very good. Chaturbhuja Narayana form. Before that, I read some line. What was that? Who is Sadashiva, I said? Sadashiva is Narayana himself. Where it is the form of Chaturbhuja. So, there is no difference between Narayana and Sadashiva. Both are same. The names, only the change of names, but both are same. I mean, I don't think I'm confusing you. So, then this is the creation part. This is the creation part and maintenance. How Lord Shiva is taking part in maintenance. So, he has a name, Bhutabhinathaya. So, he is the Bhutabhinathaya. Bhuta means what? Sometimes we say it is ghostly things, bhutas. Actually, it's Sanskrit word bhuta means all the living entities. Where Krishna says, some shloka it comes. Bhuktaram agnatapasam sarvaloka maheshwaram suhrudam sarva bhutanam. He says, sarva bhutanam. I am the well-wisher of all the bhutas. That means I am the well-wisher of all the living entities. Here, so bhutabhinathaya means, so, he is the Natha of all the living entities. So, he is the Adhishthana Devata of Panchamahabhuta. That is earth, water, air, ether, all the five things. And mind, intelligence and false ego. And foremost, to the false ego, when you have false ego, what is false ego? What is false ego? Ahankar, very good. What is Ahankar? Huh? Yes, yes. Exactly. Considering ourselves as body. That is false ego. So, ahankar, they say same word for ahankar and mithyahankar. No, it is mithyahankar like. False ego means mithyahankar, where we consider we as a body. When we have this false ego, then only we get pride. Then we get that contamination, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsarya. Everything is inside. Why? We consider as a body. Once we consider, we get self-realized that I am a soul, part and parcel of the Lord, then we don't have that contaminations of kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsaryas. That will be till then you think that you are a body. Right? And I want to explain one more thing. As false ego, when we want to be free from false ego, we have to surrender to Shiva. And who is the Adhishthana Devata for false ego? And this explains in Srimad Bhagavatam, as I was saying, the Chaturviha, Vasudev. When we wanted to get the pure consciousness, we have to worship Vasudev, the form of Vasudev, the Lord, in the form of Vasudev. And when we want to control the mind, we have to worship him in Anirudh, in the form of Anirudh. And when we want to control the false ego, we have to worship Shankarshana. Then how come we have to worship Shiva to control false ego? So Srila Prabhupada explains in the Srimad Bhagavatam this. So he explains that Lord Shiva's Aradhya Devata is Shankarsana. Lord is meditating. Lord Shiva is meditating. And this previous chapter also you can see there. There's a whole description of this chapter. Sixth chapter, you can go and read that, where Brahma satisfies Shiva. There's a description of Kailasa, how Shiva is sitting, is meditating on Lord's name. So that is Shankarsana. So this no different, because when you once surrender to Shiva, it's equivalent to that you are surrendering to Shankarsana. So you'll be free from false ego. To be free from false ego, you have to surrender to Shiva. And maintenance part. There are two kinds of maintenance. What are the two kinds of maintenance? So one is spiritual maintenance and the other is material maintenance. So for material maintenance, how Shiva is helping us? You know who is the wife of Shiva? Uma, Durga, and she is called another name as Maya Devi. And it is she who is providing all the material things for us. Right? All the fame. If you need fame, opulence, money, or material education, or marriage, good wife, good husband, good children, whom should we worship? Lord Shiva. You worship Lord Shiva, he provides all the material things you. And even Bhagavatam says, where Parikshit Maharaj asked this question to Sukadeva Goswami, what is that? Why the worshippers of Shiva, they are all opulent. They are rich. And the worshippers of Vishnu, always they are poor. And it is vice versa. You see Lord Shiva always is in graveyard, always smeared with ash, and he don't have a proper cloth. But his devotees are always opulent. And you can see Lord Vishnu is always opulent. But see his devotees always, they are like Brahmanas or Vaishnavas, always they'll be begging and depending more on the Lord. They don't have any opulence. Right? Correct? So all the material things is been provided by Lord Shiva. So is this blessing? Is this blessing to us? Everybody have a doubt. Huh? Is this proof? Purification. By material opulence you get purification. It's actually a curse. Your being more opulent is a curse. Where you get pride. You'll get more and more false ego. You get more and more addicted to this material things. The fame, opulence. And fame is certain things. We say that shackles of this material world is sex, but beyond sex it is fame. Even coming to this Krishna consciousness, some might overcome lusty desires, but the fame will not go. I wanted this position. I can't give up this position. Yes, you can see this many mutts and many things. They are spiritually so elevated. Even then, they'll be fighting. Internally, there'll be a quarrel for mutt adipati, like they want to be the supreme. They want to take over that mutts. Many organizations, many spiritual organizations can see that there'll be a fight for the fame. So this is all something like a curse. It's not a blessing. But even this is coming by Shiva. And there's another maintenance, that is spiritual maintenance. That is also done by Lord Shiva. How he does that? So spiritually, so he helps each and every soul to go back to Krishna. How he helps? So he provides different shastras like Tantra Shastra, Dharma Shastra, Artha Shastra, Jnana Shastra, Sangeeta Shastra, Bhakti Shastra. So he is the Moola Pranaya of all these shastras. Shiva is the Moola Pranaya of all this. And previous chapter, when I was reading, you can see there, when they are going in Kailas, Lord Shiva is teaching something to Narada Muni. Is explaining, and Narada Muni is just giving obeisances and is taking that knowledge from Lord Shiva. So he is the person who is giving all the transcendental knowledges. He is the person who is giving all the devotional bhakti things to all the devotees. He is the person who is helping every soul to go back to Godhead. And it is Lord Shiva who is doing this. And you can see this also in Narada Muni. Narada Muni always, he chants the holy names of the Lord and is having that tamburi and thing. Narayana, Narayana, you'll be saying, Haribam. And that Sangeeta Shastra to Narada was given by Lord Shiva. Shiva gives this Sangeeta knowledge to Narada Muni. And you can see in Kailasa what does Lord Shiva does? Always he'll be transcendental. He'll be always dancing. He'll be always singing the holy names of the Lord. And even we chant holy names of the Lord, right? Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. How many of us feeling divine, transcendental by chanting these names? And daily we honor prasadam, right? We honor daily prasadam, no? Directly we offer, and sometimes we honor even Mahaprasadam also. What we are tasting in that? We are tasting only the material taste of that food, not the divinity of that prasadam. We don't have that consciousness. This is the Uchishta of Lord Krishna who is honored. I am taking that and honoring. We don't have that consciousness. That comes when you have a complete surrender. I think you all know the story of that prasadam part. Even then only the Jagannath prasadam, where it started that everyone should have prasadam. Once, I'll say in a very short, it's getting late also. Narada Muni goes to Lakshmi Devi and he requests her that I need Mahaprasadam, that is, which is honored by Vishnu. She'll say, no, Vishnu is not recommending this, he'll not give this. Then finally, somehow, Lakshmi will go and please Vishnu, request. Then he'll say, okay, can give only little to Narada Muni because he is my devotee. Finally, little prasadam is given. Once he has that prasadam, he dances in ecstasy, right? Then he comes to Kailas. By dancing, he comes to Kailas. And Shiva says, why you are so happy today? Then he'll say, I got Mahaprasadam. Then he'll ask, how could you do this? I am your friend. How could you take alone? Why can't you give to me also? So he'll request him. Then I said, I had completely. Then you see something will be there. There will be some small particle in his nail. He'll take that in honor, that prasadam. So he'll become so transcendental. He starts dancing. It is something like Pralaya Rudra like. He stands in so transcendental. How come Shiva is having such a transcendental by having a small muscle of prasadam, and we have plates of prasadam, and we don't have any transcendental feeling with us? It's only the consciousness. Shiva is so transcendental. He's having a pure consciousness. That means he's so much surrendered to the Lord. And we have this material body, always that ego, false ego. I am this body. I am this. When you have that ego, other six things will be inside. Without that coming out, we can't taste the real namaruchi. Even chanting the holy names, you don't get that namaruchi. You don't get the transcendental taste of the prasadam. So, in this way, and you know, nowadays, there's a Bharatanatyam. You know Bharatanatyam? Who's taught that? Bharatamuni. And how did Bharatamuni get this knowledge? It's once again by Lord Shiva. The Nritya is the Thandava Nritya. He teaches this Nritya to Bharatamuni. And now it is called as Bharatanatyam. And Bhakti Shastra, even in Bhakti, he gives afterwards they'll become prayers from prayers by Lord Shiva to the Prachetas, the sons of Prachinabarhi. He teaches the transcendental prayers, what the prayers they have to do. And it's a detailed description in this chapter. And that has been given by, it is called as Rudra Geet. In Srimad Bhagavatam, you know, okay, that is Rudra Geet. And Tantra Shastra, once again, this Tantra Shastra, we have a particular vidhi vidhana, how to worship the deities. And what do we follow? Naradiya Pancharatra. Naradiya Pancharatra. And everyone has their own different Pancharatra, how to worship the deities, what is the rules and regulations, vidhi vidhana, they call it as. So in this way, and this also is taught by Lord Shiva to Narada. It is called as Narada Pancharatriya, but it has been taught by Shiva. And even Shiva explains Radha Tattva to Narada Muni. And he is Acharya of Sampradaya, Vaishnava Sampradaya, that is called as Rudra Sampradaya, where it has been by Vishnu Swami, and later part it is by Vallabhacharya. Now it's not seen, but still. So the sampradaya is coming from Shiva, and the transcendental knowledge which we are learning to understand Krishna or the transcendental scriptures, that is, we say it's coming from Saraswati. The grammatical words or syllabus which is coming from Saraswati, that is also coming from Lord Shiva's Damuruka. You know Damuruka? So by his Damuruka, all the knowledge it's coming to Saraswati. And from Saraswati we are getting this. For even for education, we worship Saraswati, no? So that is coming from Shiva's Damuruka. And so in this way, for every activity, we are dependent on Lord Shiva. I think it's getting late. And many other things have passed time. Vai is called as Ashutosh. As I said in the very beginning, there are many names. So each name, there is a full description. For Ashutosha, you can say how the meaning of Ashutosha is. What is the meaning of Ashutosha? Easily pleased, yes. Very easily he blesses you. Not that it is very difficult. Very easily. You will not even see what is your quality. You will not even see whether you are qualified to receive this. And you will come into many difficulties. Giving the boons or blessing the devotees of Lord Shiva, he himself comes in many difficulties. Like Bhasmasura. Bhasmasura will take a boon from Shiva. What he does? He gives his flesh in a yajna. Then finally he gives his head. He wants to give his head. Finally he wants to please Shiva. And Shiva will come, what you need? I need whomever I touch, they should get transformed to ash. They should burn. I should. So that is the power. When he'll hesitate, but even then he can't just, he's so compassionate. The quality of a devotee is compassionate. So Lord Shiva is so compassionate, even he knows that by giving this boon, there will be so much of difficulty, so much of problem. Even then what he does? He gives that boon. After giving that boon, what does that Bhasmasura will do? I want to have a test on this. So what? How can I test this? Keeping my hand on your head. He wants to burn Lord Shiva itself. All this demand, all the demons are the worshippers of Shiva. They know very well. Shiva is Ashutosha. He'll not see us the qualities. Once we start worshipping him and he is pleased, he'll whatever the boon he need, he'll give. But never you can see in the history of all the Shastras, all the scriptures, nowhere Vishnu has given a boon and it has created a problem. It is only Shiva where he gives this boon and always there's a problem. Why? He's called Ashutosha. He's very easily pleased. So whatever the quality you have, he'll bless you. He'll never see the sequence, what problems you face by that. Because he's so compassionate on the fallen souls. Whatever you ask, he provides that. And there's many other things like Banasura, where he gives us 1,000 hands, and finally that creates a many big problem. And Ravana also. And you know Shankarabharanam? Have you heard about this Shankarabharanam? How that has come? It was created by Ravana. To please Shiva, he'll take his intestine from the stomach, he'll take the intestine and he'll create a new musical system into that. That is called as Shankarabharanam. So in this way, you can see all the demons worshipping the Lord Shiva because he is Ashutosha. And this way, you can understand how compassionate. So there are so many things to learn from Lord Shiva. Being a devotee is known as Vaishnavanam Yathashambho, the qualities of Vaishnava. So the main qualities of Vaishnava is to be compassionate. So Vaishnava, we can recognize Vaishnava not by a tilak or chanting this. How could you recognize a devotee? How could you recognize a devotee? By his qualities. How compassionate he is. And we say, we claim ourselves to be Vaishnavas. So how many of us crying for others? So one example is Srila Prabhupada. At the age of 70, he went to America. Even at this age, we are not able to. And I'll say my personal experiences, when there is a book distribution, I need assistant. Without assistant, I'll not go for book distribution. There's a pride. I'm a circle leader. I'm a leader. Actually, the name CS, it is circle servant, but we claim ourselves as a leader. We don't have that mood of servant. We have that bhava of I am. And you can see, in this age, I need an assistant. And Srila Prabhupada went alone. And sometimes we ask to do services, Prabhu, who will be supporting me, Prabhu? We'll be asking, who is the team? Who will be supporting me? Going alone and serving, we have so many difficulties. And Srila Prabhupada, not outside, he went to America alone. He himself was cooking. He himself was translating. Just see how much difficulties he has faced. In this way, you can recognize who is a Vaishnava, who is a devotee, who is compassionate. Many others during those time, they went to America. For what sake? They went to enjoy. Because that was the most developed country or most opulent country. Everybody went there to enjoy. But Srila Prabhupada, seeing their enjoyment, he was crying that they are so ignorant, they are suffering like this. So he wants to give the transcendental knowledge. The compassion also is two kinds, that is material and spiritual. Almost, if we don't have this spiritual knowledge, we will be having compassion, but we'll be having the material compassion. Somebody is not having the food, we'll feel to feed him. If somebody is not having the cloth, we'll feed, give cloths. We see only the outer coverings, but when you have knowledge, you see the internal things. Actually, ISKCON devotees, always when there is a beggar is coming, what do you provide him? Do you give money? No, you give prasadam. You have that knowledge. You're not supporting the outer covering. You're helping the soul by giving prasadam. Not in this birth. At least after any other birth, he'll become a devotee by honoring that prasadam. Right? In this way, Vaishnavas, the first quality is compassion. So, I think I'll end this class here. And last point I want to say, after creating so much of confusions to you and many things, there is a second offense of chanting the holy name. What is this? Considering the names of demigods like Lord Shiva, Lord Brahma to be equal or independent to Lord Vishnu. After knowing so many things, now you'll be thinking, oh, Shiva is equal to Vishnu. Shiva only is like Paramatma. So many things you take. And finally, considering Shiva to be equal to Vishnu also is offense. You should understand who is Shiva, but as I said, milk will be transformed to yogurt. That means Shiva is equal to Vishnu, Vishnu is equal to Shiva, but never yogurt can be transformed to milk. So there is a difference. Achintya Beda Abeda Tattva. Hare Krishna. So, any questions, any doubt or corrections? No? Thank you. Yes, Prabhuji. So, the question is, a person, when he is facing a series of problems, health issues, family issues, financial issues, one after the other, and I have heard many devotees, they start chanting, after 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, they come back and say, what is this, Prabhu? I'm chanting the holy names of the Lord, I have become a devotee, but still I'm getting problems. Why is this? Even after chanting, I'm getting problems. Right? Everyone have this thought. Even entering to devotional service, we have these problems. Why is that? Why a devotee should get a problem? Right? Why should a devotee get a problem? The very first problem, what is that problem, you know? We are claiming ourselves to be devotees. That is the first problem creator. We are claiming ourselves, we are... Just by chanting for 1 year or 6 months or whatever, we claim ourselves, are becoming little senior in ISKCON, we think we are devotees. Already I'm taking so many classes, so many of them I have made already initiated devotees. I'm a devotee. And this is a place, it's only the spiritual thing where you yourself claim that you are a devotee. For to be a doctor, what should you do? You should do MBBS. You can't claim yourself as a doctor, right? You have to do a big course, degree, and claim. Finally, the university will claim you. You are a doctor. And for lawyer, you have to do LLB. You can't claim yourself. Oh, otherwise you can't say that my father is a lawyer, I am a lawyer. You can't say my father is a doctor, even I'll be a doctor. No, you can't do that. But spiritually, very easily you'll say, my father is an initiated devotee, even I'm a devotee. Right? Very easily we claim ourselves as devotees. But it is our guru who should title that we are devotees. He should claim you are a devotee. You have surrendered so much. You are so much humble mood. You are a devotee. He should claim. And never have seen that a guru is claiming someone as devotee. Right? But we ourselves, we claim that we are devotees. And for your problem, this thing, Prabhu, a series of things, how to come out of it, just by thinking that I am a soul, not this material body, you'll be very free. You'll come out of that. But it is not so easy to come out of it. But you can take in other way, like, you can think, Krishna is providing this kind of difficulties, means he is purifying me. As I said, Shiva is providing all the material appellants. It's not a blessing, it is curse. So Krishna is helping me. He is helping me to be a devotee. By just giving these problems, he is purifying me. The contaminations which I am just losing this. And you can see all the devotees. I have a big, I don't know where the time is affordable. You can see Bhishma. He is called as Mahajan. So how many problems did he face? He was sleeping on a bed that were arrows, full arrows on his body. Not even an inch gap was there. Even during that time, he'll take Yudhishthira to Bhishma Dev. For what? For the transcendental knowledge. He's the only person who can say about Dharma. Why? He wants to glorify his devotees. He gives the pain, and you can see the gold. How do you get the pure gold? By burning it. Otherwise, it is not pure. Only by burning, you get the purity. The same way, devotee, and I don't think Krishna will give you so much of trouble where you can't face. He gives the trouble only how much you can sustain on it, how much you can bear, so much of burden only he gives on you. So you should be confident that Krishna is there, he is the protector. He is for, even for non-devotees. What about me? I am chanting the holy names of the Lord. In that way you can think that I am a devotee. Somewhere or other, I am trying to be a devotee so that Lord is pleased. He will help me. If you have that confidence, whatever the problems comes in your life, you can face that. And it is not that devotees means it's not that problem-free. And you can see even Bali Maharaj, what is the problem he faced? He's called as Mahajan. And what is the boon? Lord is giving him. And he's a gatekeeper to Bali Maharaj. He sends to Sudhala Planet, he becomes a gatekeeper. Yes, he's giving the problems. Finally, he protects you also. In that way, once you are taken the path of devotional service, you can be very much confident that in every, each and every step, Krishna is behind me. Always is behind you, till you are not completely surrendering to him. When you get completely surrendered to him, yes, he will test you many times. When you completely surrender you to him, he comes before you. Till then, he'll be backside, he'll be protecting. Like a father. You know what the father does? He'll leave the children to work. Always he'll be behind. Any mistakes he does, he'll correct that. And he'll once again he'll leave that. Sometimes he's falling down also. A small kid is walking, means father knows he'll fall down, but even then he'll allow him. Why? He wants him to learn walking. Right? But sometimes when there's a huge danger, when you're going to fall from the top or something, he holds you. And once again he leaves, and you'll be falling, and you'll be going. You'll be scrolling. Right? In the same way. And even you can see in the example of Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada was, did not come just like that. He had so many problems. What he was not able to achieve for his 50 years, he achieved in how many years? Around 10 years something. The background of 50 years work hard, Lord was behind him. You face these problems, I'll protect you. You face, but he did not give up. When he went Jaladuta also, he got a heart attack. It was very near to Calicut. Easily he can come back, but he did not come. He never gave up. Even getting down in Boston, he was so much of troubles for 1 year, but he did not give up. Daily he'll come to the shore. When is my return to India, I'll think. But never he gave up. Then after seeing his dedication, Krishna came in the forward. What happened? Wherever he goes, only devotees. Even hippies transformed to devotees. Right? So in this way, Lord tests us. Are you really a devotee or you're pretending? If you are a real devotee, never be worried. Krishna is there to protect you. Right? Okay. Hare Krishna. Yes, Prabhuji.
Yes, yes.
Surrendering process. So it should be natural, once again. I can't say it's artificially doing something. So Krishna provides knowledge means etamam prapadyanse tam stata bacham. So how much ever you surrender, so much of mercy Lord gives, so much of understanding he gives, so much he reveals to you. But this is natural, it is not artificial. So this is also been done by the Lord only. You have to completely surrender to him. And I was reading somewhere, the Acharya say that it is not a fast rule for Lord, I am surrendering to you so that you have to give benediction to me. No. He is having his own free will. Whenever he wants to give, he can give, or he may not give also. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur says in his prayers, Rakabi marabi do chumara icha. Whatever you want to do, you do. But I am surrendered to you. I am serving you. Whatever you want to do, you do. So it depends on the Lord. Your duty is only to serve him. And Krishna gives that intelligence. So surrendering processes, be humble. As many times I say, the base of this Krishna consciousness is Trinadapi Sunichena Tarorapi Saishnura Amanina Manadena Kirtanya Sadahari. And Kirtanya Sadahari will happen only when you are in this mood. Trinadapi Sunichena, thinking that I am equivalent to a blade of grass on the street, being humble. Tarorapi Saishnura, so being tolerant like a tree. Among devotees also, there will be so many things coming up where you don't like this devotee, you like this devotee. Yes? Yeah, so many things. But you have to tolerate those things and mingle with all the devotees. Everybody are practicing devotees. So you'll have many problems. Even then you tolerate that. And more important qualities, amanina manadena. Never ever expect for any respect. And think everyone are beyond you. And start respecting everyone. Be a humble servant to all the devotees. And never, never expect any, even while saying Hare Krishna also, you should say Hare Krishna. And never expect the other devotee should say Hare Krishna. And sometimes we say Hare Krishna, he is not saying Hare Krishna. He himself is not saying, why should I say? No. You forget about the others. You first be a devotee. You should progress in Krishna consciousness. Not that you are making him to progress. And preaching, I want to speak, say something to the preachers also. You are preaching, this means for your purification. And never you think that I am preaching so that they have to become a devotee. See, so many times I am preaching them, they are not at all surrendering, they are not at all chanting, they are not at all. No, that is not your duty. Your duty is only to preach. And Krishna, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu helps them to do that. Krishna, what is the instruction of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? Yare deko karo, Krishna upadesh. That is your duty. Just glorify Krishna, say about Krishna, that's it. Don't expect for the result. And Krishna will do that. It is none of our business to see the result of other devotee. It is seeing that I should become a devotee. This is the humble state. I never expect for. Only in this situation you can chant the holy names. Now we are chanting. But that's something like a practice. When you come to this real platform, then you have that taste of Harinam. Then you'll be like Lord Shiva. Hare Krishna means you start dancing. Not like this kind of dancing, simply dancing, no. Transcendental dancing, like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. When he chants, he just faints and falls down. That is transcendental. Just nobody feels to dance. Just by chanting, automatically that happens. So, not like artificial. It's natural. It should be natural. Okay? So, I'll end the class here. Granthrat Srimad Bhagavatam Ki.